in studio, we are four, and while I was just quiet going through my phone and checking about the updates of what's happening elsewhere as far as sports is concerned, the three gentlemen were so into deep discussion about basketball, and I think I'm just asking myself, is football overrated locally? It means people are so passionate about a game that used to be in the knowledge of public domain some time back, but it looks its restoration is back on fold. Of course, it's about, we discuss about the development of basketball in Kenya and, you know, the progress of, you know, Kenya Morans in Yaounde, Cameroon, where they're taking part in 2021 Afro Basketball Qualifiers. Remember, they will be playing their second game of the campaign tonight against Angola, having lost yesterday in their first game against Senegal. Joining me is one man who's been passionate about the game, a coach, and of course a cyclist as well, juggling between the two. I don't know how he's been maneuvering to ensure success. Zedekiah Otieno, also known as Zeddy, good to see you, man. How have you been?
Been okay.
Yes.
Just keeping healthy, as you have said, through cycling, and just enjoying local sports at the same time international.
Are you still passionate about cycling? The last time you were here in studio, you were talking about an initiative that you are doing with regards to ensuring that you bring a lot of young people together to do cycling. And I've seen even the second lady, Rachel Ruto, is also passionate about cycling with her team.
Yes, and I like even what they're doing, even with the expressway and the new roads that are coming up, because they're putting in cycling lanes. So it's a good thing. Cycling is very, very healthy, and it's a good way to keep fit and lose weight. And yes, the initiative is still on. A lot of young people are still joining cycling. And I think it's another sport that in the next 2-3 years should be making news and headlines in the sporting world.
Yesterday, of course, we saw Kenya losing against Senegal 69-51.
Yes.
And I think Kenya were on the verge of winning that particular game, but of course Senegal came from behind to overtake them. I don't know, what do you think might have transpired in between? Let's start from there.
I think we started well. The tempo was so high in the first two quarters. Remember, in the second quarter, we outscored them. But they came in the third and fourth quarter, and they outscored us. Remember, they went on like a 10-0 run in the third quarter. Taking away the quarter 25-10, that is 15 points in that quarter. In the last quarter, again, it was another big run for Senegal, 17-10. And we had a lot of turnovers in the third, in the fourth turnovers. And now I think maybe the fatigue was kicking in, heavy legs on the players. And I just hope they've gotten enough rest to just ensure that they see off Angola today.
But from the game we watched yesterday between Kenya and Senegal and the other one which we played in the early months, what kind of major difference did you see in this team?
I think there have been major improvements from even the technical staff. We have a new coach, Liz Miles. She's very, very vast when it comes to African basketball. She has transformed us. Yes. Remember yesterday we were going so much to the line. It means we are more attacking. Yes. Things that we didn't do last time. We are playing with a lot of free will. We are not playing a lot of structured basketball, so it means players are able to express themselves. Again, he has a new team because she has been able to drop a few players. We have seen the likes of Bosire being left behind, Fahim being left behind. Now, last time Bungei was not able to play because he was not cleared. He's now playing. Mukota, last time had contracted COVID, is now able to play. So I think he had a very, very good team to choose from.
Yes.
And I think we did well. Because remember last time we lost 35 points. Yesterday we lost by 17 points, and that is a big achievement.
That is a big achievement indeed. What do you think about, you know, the blend of youth and experience in the squad? Of course, Kenya, it's a do or die for them in tonight's clash against Angola. And that's equally another Herculean task for them to beat Angola, which he has invested heavily in basketball. How should be the approach to this particular clash by coach?
I think we just need to be clinical in our finishing and in our shot selection. Remember, the amount of 3 points that we took yesterday did not fall. So there is the difference. Because remember, Senegal, Angola, they're big. We are not blessed with the length and the physique. So the best you can do is work on our speed, quick transition basketball. At the same time, get good shot selection, and we just have to be clinical in our finishing. Because remember, we lost to Angola last time by 17 points. And if we could replicate what we did yesterday against Senegal to Angola today, and I've just seen news in that Awich has been cleared to play, Joel Awich. So that also adds something, because now we have depth at the post position, and I think we should be able to do or have a good game tonight.
Let's do a squad selection with the players you have mentioned, like Awich has come in and Asonso Legari is in the squad. What will be your best five going against Angola today in your prediction lineup?
I think my best five, I'll have Omkota start together with Desmond at the post area. Then I'll have Bungei, I'll have Taylor, and I'll have Awich, Joel Awich start, because these are players that they are playing international basketball. They're very, very vast. They have a lot of experience. They bring a lot of depth into the team. And I think that lineup may be able to give us a good run before we start making a rotation and see the likes of Wamutoro, Griffin, just come in and give them rest.
Yeah. It has to be a tough for coach also, considering she has been with the team for 1 month and the other internationals had to fly in. Was that a major impact onto the game?
It's always a major impact, because remember, when you are going for such tournaments, you are not going there to participate, you're going there to compete.
Yes.
So you want to bring your best, and you bring your best, it means that you have to prepare your best adequately. She has had 1 month to prepare the team, but I believe with the 1 month, the players that are in the team, their level of basketball understanding is high.
Yes.
They're well coordinated. They have played, they play week in, week out. Remember, like the players like Taylor,
yes.
Taylor Okari plays in the Basketball Champions League.
Yeah.
We see him play week in, week out. The likes of Des as well in Australia, they play week in, week out. So I don't think that should be a bigger challenge. Only the rotation that she needs to focus on. Make sure that they get a lot of rest. Yesterday, Bungei had like 18 minutes in the first half. I think he needs to, she needs to reduce that, maybe to around maybe 12, 14, yeah. Just to give him enough rest so that he can be able to go in the second half.
Of how much influence is the local based players led by the likes of Ariel Okal? Because it's a blend of those playing at home and even the foreign based players. How significant are they to be, you know, blended with the you know, those playing their trade professionally overseas?
Remember, whether they're playing abroad or they're playing locally,
yes.
It means these are our best players.
Yes.
So they've been in camp, they've been here. Remember when we started the qualifiers in Uganda, they came to Kenya, we went to Rwanda, now they're in Cameroon, and they have been there. So they have the experience, they have the know-how to maneuver and ensure that we get these two wins today. Yes, we need one win, but the two wins. Remember, at the end of the day, us having the two wins means that when they do the draws, it means it's gonna give us an easier route in the next round. But when we finish third, it means you're gonna get the likes of Egypt, the likes of Tunisia, and again, it's gonna be a very, very difficult route for us maybe to win the championship, the African championship. And remember the last time we were there, 27, 28 years ago, we finished fourth. So we already have been there, we have finished fourth, so we cannot go there and make sure we just participate. We have to go there, compete, and try backing that fourth position.
Man, it's been a long time of waiting, several years down the line, when Kenya has not made it to the elite, you know, continental competition. And now this is an opportunity. How well can we defy all odds to qualify? Like in football, we did it in 2019. After 15 years of waiting, Kenya made it to the continental stage. Aaron, is it possible for the basketball?
It's possible, because remember when we hosted the games here last year in February, South Sudan had never qualified. They've never played. We beat them here. They got a wild card. Again, they were beaten. They got another wild card. But look at now, Sudan has qualified for the first time for the African Championship. So why not Kenya? We only need one game to qualify and just rewrite everything back again. So I believe by the end of tomorrow, we'll have written history, we'll have qualified, and that will give us ample time just to come back, regroup, coach to have ample time with the team, even have a chance to watch the local league, which is also about to start, and maybe get other people on board that are equally talented and deserve the chance. And maybe we'll see maybe a change in guard or in terms of players that are selected and everything, and maybe go there and have a good result.
Indeed, of course, we're discussing about the development of basketball in the country. Is joining us Zedekiah Otieno, also known as Zedi, a renowned basketball coach, of course, still pursuing his initiative of Elite Vikapu basketball tournament. How is the progress so far, by the way? Just to digress a little bit.
Yeah, basketball development is key. All this we are talking today is all about basketball development. All these players that are playing overseas and stuff, they started somewhere developing their skill. And that is why maybe somebody identified them and, okay, they got an opportunity maybe to travel abroad or to go live abroad and play basketball. So it's so critical in our fabric when we want like to grow the sport, any sport, whether basketball, cycling and everything. Vikapu is doing very, very well. We have a new home right now, just adjacent to State House at La Velata. We normally meet there every week, every Saturday morning from 8 a.m. To 10:30. And it's all about developing these kids. And when you start shipping players out in terms of them going to high school abroad, going to college abroad, as we try to organize ourselves, it's not like we cannot do this locally. We can do this locally. But now there are better infrastructure, there are better coaches outside there, there are better facilities outside there. So if you are able to take them out, they access this infrastructure, they access these opportunities, then we are able to ensure that we have a sustainable program. Even now the Morans, it will not be like, okay, they go put up a show and we come back, we don't have something to present, we have a gap. And also the newly elected federation have an opportunity now to restructure. So that
is it the newly elected or the newly re-elected?
The newly elected. They have an ample chance and opportunity.
Yes.
Just to make sure they put in the structures so that we start seeing under-12s competing also as well, because we also have AfroBasket for under-12, under-16, under-18. Then we are able, like, okay, to identify, they're able to get the exposure, and we are able to make sure that this is consistent.
You know, a lot of my friends who are watching the show might be interested in taking their kids to Vikapu Elite Basketball Initiative, but since you mentioned something to do with State House, you know, with the high cost of living right now, maybe they might be scared of coming because of the hiked charges. I don't know.
No.
You talked about it at detailed, tell us about the charges, the rates.
They're very, very fair charges. Because you are adjusting to State House, it doesn't mean that our charges are high. No. It's just a normal program, like any program we'll find in Kayole, Madare, wherever. The only thing they have to pay is for the venue. We still don't have a venue there. So the only thing they have to pay is the venue, and maybe buy their kids our training kit.
What happened with your previous venue, Hillcrest?
Hillcrest, new management. We had to move to Strathmore. Strathmore, now COVID and everything.
Yeah.
They haven't really opened. So by good chance, somebody introduced us to the Matiba family, and they've given us a lease there, just into State House, and we really, really thank them for that.
What I'm getting is that for basketball in Kenya to go to the higher level and to the highest levels is a very serious structured youth program. And you realize that from these other countries like Senegal, Angola, Mali, Egypt, Tunisia, they have got those youth programs. How is that key for us, considering that most of our basketball players started majorly in high school? That's when we started learning basketball and all that. But in primary level, it's very few schools that have basketball. So how is the youth program key for basketball development in Kenya?
It's very, very key. And there is a group, I'm part of a group called Far East Basketball Association. They're based in Kayole, Diwopa. They have ensured that all the 7 public primary schools within Kayole have a basketball court and have a coach. So every term, these kids are trained basketball, and they are able to compete at the end of the term in a tournament called Big Dreams, Big Stars. So it's very, very vital for us to have these structures, not only in basketball, even in football. Because if you look at Senegal, they have the junior, the NBA Academy based in Senegal, plus they have the seed program being led by Amadou Gaffol. And these are programs that bring in coaches from abroad to scout players. And when you are, Maxwell was talking about Nigeria having like 7-6 players having been drafted to the NBA. Yes. Where did all this start? They started in the Power Forward Basketball Academy in Nigeria, because that is the biggest program in Nigeria. So also in Kenya, as much as we have Vikapu, as much as we have maybe FIRST Basketball Association, we have Slam Dunk, we need to have a national outlook program that these kids can always be channeled to, and we are able to expose them so they are able to be identified way, way early. Yeah. So they get opportunities to maybe go high school abroad, go college abroad, and surely we'll see them, if not playing in the EuroLeague, maybe playing in the NBA or other big leagues in the world.
Yeah. Considering that we have now very many Africans playing in the NBA.
Remember also we have what is called BAL. BAL is an African concept of the NBA, which is now starting.
And yes,
for the, if we put in the structures that are needed, it means in the next 5 years, we'll not have to ship players to the States, to Europe. And no, we'll have to just nurture a local-based players here and then playing in the BAL competition.
Yeah.
But the only thing that we need to do is infrastructure, infrastructure, infrastructure. There are so many groups that are coming up, building basketball facilities around Nairobi and stuff, but also this needs to go past Nairobi. We need to see them in Nakuru, we need to see them in Eldoret, we need to see them in Kisumu, we need to see them in Mombasa.
Yeah.
That is the only way, because like now, basketball is not an outdoor game. It's an indoor game. The reason why maybe we cannot host some of these games is because of what? Maybe you have Nyayo and you have Kasarani as the only indoor gyms that are public, not private.
Yeah,
yeah, because some of the private gyms are expensive. So even the government, I like what CS Amina, she's doing, going all around, ensuring that all sporting facilities are done ahead of time.
Yeah.
But as they do this, as they do basketball, they need to ensure that basketball, it is an indoor game.
Yeah.
And they build as gyms so that we are able to host other teams both locally and internationally in indoor facilities.
And then now we've got our high school, because that is where now we start our basketball, most of us here in Kenya. How has it been and how is it doing so far? Is it still that our high school is very good in development for Kenyan basketballers?
Our high school is okay, because they have a structure, everything is sorted, because they start playing in the sub-zonals, zonals, districts, then they go to sub-county, county, then from county they go to nationals, from nationals they go to East African games. So there's a structure. So if you want a player, you can follow through the player. Players, a lot of games to play within, so you're able to track players. But that is not good enough. That quality of talent that is there is not good enough.
Yeah.
That is why we have to go back and start it at primary school. And once you start it at primary school, like now, we have a gap. We may not see it, but we have a gap.
Yeah.
Yeah. At college level, let's say like now, when these Moran teams now, they exit, there's a very, very big gap. But we need to go back to our colleges, make sure that we fill that gap. Because you have players in KU, Nazarene, Riara, who can fit in. So we need to start nurturing them way, way early. Then once that is done, okay, high school, who are there? Then form ones, form twos, who are there? Then primary school, who are there? Then under 10, who are there? Because we have under 10s who are playing basketball. So it's fair enough if we start putting them in this structure so that we're able to follow them through until they get to the senior most.
Yeah, in that level. Even when they get into, when you are doing under 10, by the time you get into high school, you already understand the basics. Now you're learning the game in full detail the way they do it in the outside world. One question is, remember in 94-95 when our ladies team made it to the World Championships?
Yeah.
And that was a big one for Kenya in the 90s, and our basketball through the 70s, the 80s was also a big thing in Africa and here in the country. Do you see us going back to those glory days?
Why not? Why not? We can go back to those glory days. The things that we need, the first thing is planning. How do we get there? And us getting there means that we need to start identifying these talents when they are 10, 12-year-olds.
Yes.
We cannot start working with 15, 16-year-olds. We need
when
to work with
already
10.
Up,
yes.
Yeah.
Identify them, kids that are athletic, they're lengthy. They start teaching them how to go for layups, how to shoot. Then put them in a program. Then start exposing them way, way early when they're 10.
Yes.
Because remember, I took a team last year, but one, to South Africa. When they go to South Africa, the games are being played in like... in a ballroom. As you're used to, ballrooms are places where we have meetings, we have exhibitions, but these people had converted the ballroom to a basketball court. So there was AC and everything, there was carpet besides the court. So at the end of the day, players are shocked.
Because
it's a culture shock for them. Yeah. It's a new experience. Mm-hmm. But you see, when this kid is 10 or 12, they start experiencing these things, then it gets to them. When you get here, we need to start competing. We need to play at this level. Yeah. This is expected of us. Our execution needs to be like this. So then it gets easier when this kid is 15, when this kid is 16, when this kid is 17. By the time this kid is 17, trust you me, he has played against Angola, he has played against Tunisia, he has played against Mozambique. He knows Mozambique, they are short, they run. He knows that Senegal, they are tall, they are skilled, but they don't run. So they're able to adjust. So it's doable. I know the Lionesses, I know they have qualifiers as well in the next month or two. And I know the Federation is going to do a good job the way they've done with the men's team.
Yeah.
And we wish that they can replicate what they replicated.
Talking about the Federation, you had the election and everything that has come in. And there's usually this debate and conversation that goes around in everything. Some of the major sports that are given government attention has got to be athletics. We've got football. They have given government attention and all that. But when it comes to basketball, I think it was last year, when we started seeing government now trying to come in, but not coming in fully to support basketball as a game here in Kenya. How has that impacted basketball, that lack of government attention?
I think when you're in a family of like maybe let's say 12, 6,
yes,
you as a child, at least you have to be the stubborn one or you have to make noise.
Yeah.
So it's a good thing with the noise that maybe the Morans are making and everything. And at least now the government is trying to turn the attention. Okay, there's a sport here. Yeah. So I think also the guys who are being re-elected into the Federation, they have work to do to ensure that they package the basketball well, because now this is a product.
Yeah.
So how best do you sell this product to the consumers?
Yeah.
So if they're able to do that, there is a lot of vibe. When we're offline, we are talking about the NBA.
Yeah.
Anytime maybe you get to the playoffs and the NBA are running, at least 1.3 million people are streaming those games live.
Yes. Yes.
And these are people that are where? In Kenya. Mm-hmm. So how do we turn these 1.3 million people or viewers who are able to tune in at 6 a.m., 4 a.m. to watch an NBA game into a local fan base?
Yes.
And that can only be done when we package basketball in a good way, commercialize it. They're able to see it on TV. They're able to see it maybe on YouTube and everything. Mm-hmm. And convert that into revenue for the federation, for the basketball in Kenya. And at the end of the day, whether the government comes in or not, will be sorted.
Yeah.
But I like the noise that is there. They need to keep on making the noise. They need to keep on pushing the government, because at the end of the day, the government, they have to come in and support the programs. But government only comes in when there are structures and there is a good vibe around it.
And then now, that will be a follow-up to the Federation, that they need to make the Kenyan basketball marketing to be a very key product, so that a Kenyan audience can sit and actually say, I want to watch this product.
Of course, of course. There's no two about it.
Yeah.
When you read about sports marketing and you start asking yourself, what is sports marketing? Sports marketing is very, very simple. You have this sport. How do I convert this into a what? Into a money-making business that people can buy. When you have quality games, you have quality highlights, when you can profile your players, people are interested because they can associate themselves with some of these players.
Yes.
Yeah. But when we are not able to do that, then we lose it. Because how did rugby do it? How did football do it? Why are they signing contracts left, right, and center?
Mega contracts.
Yes. Yeah. Why not basketball? So it means there's something that you're not doing right, and you need to go get it right. Mm-hmm. And Morans are doing a very good job by leading the way in terms of them winning, making a lot of noise outside there. So the federation needs to take a leaf and convert all this vibe into commercial and make sure they package it well and sell it out. Because if they don't do it, it right now when everything is on the high, then once it comes down, it's going to be hard to revive it.
And I think all these things we're talking about boils down to the leadership and administration of the game. At the federation level, those honchos have been there. Like in basketball, Paul Otula is there, who has been the long-serving president of Kenya Basketball Federation. And he's been a principal of serious high schools in the country, which are reputable when it comes to matters basketball at Maseno. And he's well known for, you know, getting involved in churning out of talents. And even right now, as we speak, he's at Sunshine, which is a school not well known for basketball, but I think it is something that can be initiated. Peter Orero, the treasurer of KBF, has been in Upper High School right now. He's in Dagoretta, and we've seen how he's trying to bring the game to a school that was not well known for sports. How well can these people be involved now that they are at the helm of federation and ensure that whatever we're talking about comes into actualization?
I think they know what needs to be done, and they have a lot of goodwill, because if you even interact with them when they're doing their other businesses that are not basketball related, they're very, very good people to relate with. And at the end of the day, they just need to delegate and bring people around them that maybe may help or give them that push. Because at the end of the day, if you delegate something and it happens and you're at the helm, who takes credit? It's you is there.
Yes.
So I believe they have a four-year term, and I believe it's going to be a four-year term that has a lot to do in it. I remember he won the election with a very, very slim margin of around 11 votes.
Yeah.
So it means it's a divided house. Yeah. It's not like, okay, I can say, okay, I have my people, or I have my way. So a lot of consultation needs to happen. A lot of goodwill needs to happen for us to move basketball forward.
Yeah.
But there are 4 years to make sure that they change the terrain of basketball.
Yeah.
After maybe 2-3 years,
I think also this will be his last term, following with what the Sports Act put
in
place.
He was given a run for his money by Cynthia Mumbo, who just announced candidates, I think,
seven days before
the election day.
Yes.
And of course, she did very well, getting lost by a slim margin of around
11 votes. Yes.
And I think talking about Cynthia Mumbo, she's our good friend. She's been a friend of the show, and she lost the father. And I think we take this opportunity to submit our condolences and hope that God gives her much needed strength and fortitude to withstand with the big loss. Of course, she's the CEO of Sports Connect Africa and very passionate about the game. So, how has it been like since the elections? You know, I've seen some new faces coming into KBF.
I can't talk much about the federation because I'm not in it.
Yes.
But I'll say...
And you also don't want to make enemies.
At the end of the day, we love the game. At the end of the day, we love the game. We may agree, disagree, but our disagreement is all because of the game that we love.
Yeah,
and we want to just make a difference and an impact at the end of the day. But I believe that I've done well. You have seen the team get a new coach. You have seen the team get good preparation and stuff. There is a lot of good vibe around the team. The team has been able to travel. Like in the past, whereby such things were like, okay, the team can't travel, we don't have resources. They've put in a few committees that are trying to do the right thing. So I believe so far, so good. We have seen
the progress is encouraging.
Yes, they're trying to revive the league, which is okay. So hopefully, let's give them time and see what they do. And hopefully, things will change.
Talking about the reviving the league, you are saying the Minister of Sports is now giving some set of guidelines on some of the games that are coming back. You saw athletics is back at the moment. Football also got a chance to come back. Rugby has been given a go-ahead also to come back. They'll be playing today a curtain raise and then open with match day one next week. What about basketball? Is there a chance of it coming back?
I think it's back. Games are being played in Kiambu Road even today. Yes, yeah. I think it's back. There was an AGM, then there was a team managers meeting. There are teams that are still not ready to play, but teams that are ready to play, the fixtures are already out. Today we had some of the coastal teams travel to Nairobi. I think they're currently playing in Kiambu. I've just seen Coastal Kings were playing against Blazers, which Coastal King has won 57-37, something like that. So I think the league is slowly coming, but also, again, with COVID measures, players being tested, they have to be masked all the time and just make sure that everybody's healthy and safe at the end of the day.
So Zedi, as we wind up, just tell us about, you know, your prospects ahead of tonight's clash, Kenya against Angola. Moran looking forward to step up their performance and, you know, leave behind the miseries of yesterday's loss against Senegal so that they can cement their chances of making it through to the 2021 Afro Basketball. How significant is that competition, first of all? How crucial is it?
I think
I've seen much hype around it.
Yeah, it's very, very crucial for us because for us to position ourselves as big boys of basketball in Africa, then we need to be there. We need to start dining with the big boys. Sorry to bring this to the local politics, but the Hustler Nation are saying that they also want to be on the table, dining with the rest and making. So same thing with basketball. We need to be there. At the helm, be with the big boys because Kenya is very, very.
Who are the big boys? Sudan, Egypt.
Sudan are not the big boys. There are young boys coming into.
So who are the big boys?
The big boys there are Egypt, Tunisia, because the North Africans.
Yes.
Again, Senegal is still there. Angola is still there. South Africa is still there. So those are the countries that we need to surround ourselves with. Again, FIFA ranking. It also means that our players can play like in the Champions League. If you are low ranked, it means you cannot play in the Basketball Champions League. So again, these are some of the things that we.
What do you think happened in between? Because when we were growing, we were on same level playing grounds with those countries you've mentioned. Kenya was at par with the likes of, you know, Egypt, Senegal, the North African giant, South Africa.
We stopped planning.
But do you think complacency in between?
Yes, we stopped planning. At the end of the day, all these things are. You need to plan way in advance. We know FIBA calendar for the next 3-4 years. It's out there. So it means as a federation, how best do I plan to ensure that I attend all these things? Because that is my mandate as a federation. As an outsider, I cannot come and do that for the federation. Federation needs to know there is this under 18 championship, there is this Afro Basketball qualifiers. So at the end of the day, we just need to plan for these things and make sure that they get actualized. Coming back to today, Angola versus Kenya, it's a big game. It's a very, very big game. We need to win today. We need to win tomorrow against Mozambique.
Yes.
These games, they make us be in a good position for the next round in terms of pooling and everything. We win one game, yes, well and good. Our foot is inside. We'll have qualified for the first time in 27 years, but we need the rankings. We need a good seeding for the next round so that things are a little bit easier. Because again, it's not going to be easy because everyone who has qualified, they're big dogs. So I just want to wish the team well. I know there is a lot of hype, a lot of psych in the camp and everything. I talked to the coach yesterday and she's very, very positive of a better result. And we lost to them by 17, and I believe they can lose to us today by 17.
Definitely. Of course, everyone is very positive. Boy, and ahead of tonight's clash, Kenya Morans against Angola playing at 10 p.m. East African time. This is 2021 Afro Basketball qualifiers, which Kenya is looking forward to make it through after, despite the fact that they lost their first game of the campaign in Yaounde, Cameroon against Senegal yesterday. Though by a slim margin, contrary to what happened towards the end of last year, where they lost spectacularly and under the tutelage of Liz Mills, who is the new coach and one of the experienced coach as far as basketball is concerned globally. We hope that things will be different going forward. Zedekea Otieno, also known as Zedia Basketball Coach, with much info about the game, joining us this particular afternoon to tell us and discuss about development of the sport in the country. And you've heard him reiterating the aspect of, you know, structures and policies being put in place and huge investment, especially amongst the upcoming talent. Always an honor having you on board. We hope to talk about this going forward so that our game can continue growing and we can continue getting it to the, you know, in limelight where it was some time back.
We will get there. There's a lot of goodwill from us development coaches, programs, investment, so we will get there.
Definitely. Of course, the show still continues until 3 o'clock. Remember, tomorrow, Arsenal up against Manchester City, and this man is putting on an Arsenal shirt. I've never seen an Arsenal fan who is so proud like him.
Yeah, Arsenal
tomorrow.
Was it a
coincidence or?
No. It's weekend. I support my team. My team is Arsenal. We had a shaky performance in the Europa League, but I believe we can shake that off on Man City. Remember, again, it's the mentor meeting
the mentee.
Yes.
It's a discussion we're delving into in the next few minutes. Don't go away. Stay tuned. It's The Touchline.